I've been out all night trying to find you. Calling, but you won't pick up the phone. Dragging your heavy heart behind you. Do you really want to be alone? Head down, dark clouds moving in. You're not the weather, you're not the wind, you're Grandfather Mountain. The rain comes, the rain goes. You are still standing. How easily blue skies turn to thunder. Just a word could bring you to your knees. Well, you got a choice to run for cover, or you could feel the earth strong as steel under your feet. Head down, dark clouds move. Still standing. You are still standing. No bad advice, no Bible verse, a promise I won't say a word. But if you think you need a friend, if you wanna let me in, when it's really coming down, together we can ride it out. No feeling is forever, your head down, dark clouds moving in. But you're not the weather, you're not the winds, you're Grandfather Mountain. The rain comes, the rain goes, and you are still standing. You are still standing.
I remember finding this prayer that starts, above all, trust in the slow work of God.
Well, isn't it so hard for most of us to find the kind of patience that will trust the slow, steady work of God beneath the surface, every moment working for our good. Under all the snow is something green, hiding in the winter is a spring. And I know it will take the barren field of heartbreak a little time for a new rain to fall.
He won't waste a word. I'm gonna wait. I'll wait on the Lord. Well, surely I've been wrong along the way, but I will not be called by my mistakes. He calls me his friend when all I see is where I've been. I hear him tell me where I am going, and I will not hang my head. His banner is over me, and he said, there's no wound he cannot heal. There's no child too far gone. I'm the clay on his spinning wheel, and he knows what I'll become. I will not hang. So I'm gonna wait. Yes, I'm gonna wait. Oh, I'm gonna wait. I'll wait on the Lord.
Good evening. Good evening. I'm Luke Powery, the Dean of Duke Chapel, and welcome to the chapel for this public conversation on complicated truths. On your way in, I hope you were able to view and engage with the Reliquary of Complicated Truths exhibition on this side wall to my right. It's a significant part of the context for this evening's conversation, and that exhibition will be here in the chapel through Monday. This building, Duke Chapel, is a sanctuary for all people, where we seek to bridge faith and learning by nurturing and embodying the intellectual, ethical, and spiritual life. Because of that, it is indeed a fitting place to wrestle with the complicated truths of life for which there are no easy solutions. This evening, we are privileged to hear insights into these complicated truths from two gifted individuals working in different media, a multidisciplinary artist, Duke alumna, Lanecia Rouse Tinsley, and then my Duke Divinity colleague and friend, professor and writer, Kate Bowler. They will be more fully introduced in a moment. I'd also like to thank our partners, Duke Divinity School and the Everything Happens Initiative for making this event possible. Following this conversation, all are invited to stay for the chapel's choral vespers service at 7 p.m. Thank you all for coming this evening. I hope the complicated truths we hear about this night will set us all free. And now I'd like to invite my colleague and Duke Divinity School Dean, Edgardo Colon Emmerich, to come and offer an opening prayer.
Paz y bien, peace and well-being be with all of you. Let us pray. O God, our help in ages past and hope for years to come, we come before you in a complicated time, a time of pandemic and polarization, a time of worries and war, a time of horrors and inhumanity. In this complicated time, I thank you for Kate and Lanecia. Use these witnesses and this conversation to remind us that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, that you knit us together and pressed on us your image, and that when this image was defaced by the names that others have called us and the lies that we told ourselves, you wrote a new name on these frail fallen relics of your creative dreams, the new name of beloved. So send your spirit into this place, the spirit of truth, to lead us into complicated truths for complicated times, and into the mysterious truth that there is no cure for being human because you, God, became human. Amen.
Man, that was, come on, I mean, ridiculously. Hello, lovelies, thank you for coming. This on a terrible, miserable, gorgeous, in the faith in a deeply metaphorical way. Hello. Yeah. And what a beautiful way to be set up by people who look through the eyes of God and call us beloved, or who believe that God sees us as poetry. Mm. Oh, tell me that line again, Taylor.
I love that.
It was so good. Is that your song? It's yours. Come on. I am his poetry, he won't waste a word. Thank you so much to the for the inestimable gifts of Taylor Linhart. So grateful. Doesn't it feel so good when people just pour their beauty on you? And I feel really lucky that we get to do that tonight. My name is Kate Bowler. Listen to the bells when this whole thing happens at 5 p.m. every day. It is a joy to be here. And thanks so much to Luke and to the chapel and to Edgardo and Duke Divinity School and to Jeremy and Dan and the Dita. They have this gorgeous initiative in arts. Am I making terrible sounds to you? Yes. Do they feel improved?
I think so.
Yeah? Do they do? Great. So. Wonderful. Amazing. So you've already heard the singer-songwriter based in Nashville, Taylor Linhart, and you are here tonight to hear my beautiful friend, Lanecia Rouse Tinsley, share about the work of accounting for fragility in a world that imagines that our impermeability is the sign of our victory. And we just don't feel like doing it right now.
No.
I think.
Ever.
She is a wildly talented multidisciplinary artist. She is also a Duke Divinity School graduate, so we're just gonna take a minute to feel reflected glory. Thank you. She's also the owner and creator of LAR Art Studio and the artist in residence for Holy Family in Houston. And you will want very much to, it feels crass to say, you will want to follow her on social media, but you really will, at LAR Art Studio and also LaneciaRouseTinsley.com. But she is a spectacular human being. And my friend, thank you so much for doing this with me today.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. It's good to be here. Hello, welcome.
I feel like we have the hardy people that survived the cold.
Yeah, I think we're good.
Am I making terrible sounds?
It sounds bad
to me, but it sounds great to you. So that's really all that matters. But if at the back you start to do this, I will yell, are you not entertained? And then I'll fix it, I promise. I thought maybe we could start and talk about the narrow and wide work of ministry. You were trained, of course, here in this neo-Gothic masterpiece, and you could have stayed on a very narrow ministerial track. I wondered if you could tell me about your life in the church and then to art.
Yeah, so I am telling my age here. I graduated here in 2003 and entered into full-time ministry, mostly youth ministry. Got to spend some time in England for a year, which was phenomenal. Came back to Nashville, Tennessee, and constantly in ministry, I found myself burning out. I would get in it, full-hearted, and burn out fast, depression would hit me. And I always felt like I was just wearing clothes that didn't quite fit, you know? Always in the background, in the quiet of my house, in the silence, in the shadows, I would be playing my guitar and singing or finding some way to photograph life with my camera, you know? And creating art, even though I was the kid who got the C in art class in seventh grade, right? And began to believe, I'm not an artist. I always wanted to be. And in 2010, I had a breakdown of sorts. And in the midst of that, met two pastors from Houston, Texas, who invited me to come to St. John's downtown and be loved on and join what they called was the Love Revolution. And my role in that revolution was directing an art therapy, therapeutic art and economic empowerment project with men and women living on the streets. And so I went, even though I didn't really think I was an artist. They said they needed me for other things. And by golly, while I was there, I began to rediscover my creative self. Alongside in the shelter, some of the people in the program would teach me. I'd sit in on their workshops, and I found a lot of life in creating with my hands and some joy. And then life kind of had an interruption that opened a door.
So. Yeah. It's amazing, too, how other people's precarity, like other people's contingency, helps us realize we don't. That like beauty opens up something in us and it almost demands that we respond sometimes.
Yeah,
I know that you have like entered into the like soft heart of that like experience of gospel transcendence and just in different way. I don't think that I would have tried doing anything other than history and like bless history. I'm really only good from like 1950s onwards. It's really the only stuff I know. I'm really quite proud of it. But I don't think I would have even thought to have like the courage to try something else if I didn't feel quite so humbled by brokenness, I guess. And then almost not having as much, maybe I'm going to reach for the word dignity, but just like, you know, I didn't really have enough to feel pride. I just thought, well, maybe what if I just try and then see, and then maybe no one has to see it, but then at least I made something beautiful or something.
Made a thing. Yeah, that was pretty much my life. And most of it was guided by fear. Like, I was just afraid. I would tell people I loved that this is a thing I want to do, you know? Yeah. Yeah. I thought, I had dreams of singing on a stage, you know, or photographing and documenting stories, but I was just always afraid until 2013. Cleve and I found out that we were having, Cleve is my partner and my husband, and we found out we were having a little girl. AJ is her name. And with her presence, just that life within me, I knew that I needed to do some work to be the mother I wanted to be for her. And I didn't want to raise a child that was guided by fear, but more so guided by her delights and passions and what gave her joy in life. And so I started doing the work myself. And knew eventually, though I imagine it would be a lot slower than it ended up being, that I would leave ministry. But when we lost her in December of that year, less than five months later, life stopped for me, Kate, you know? And I experienced a shattering and a breaking open unlike anything I'd ever experienced before. And I knew that, one, this pain would be with me forever. And so it wasn't a matter of trying to figure out like how to erase a pain and do that kind of work. And then, you know, for so long I'd stuff stuff, you know, we hide and we smile ourselves into strength. But I was broken and I knew that the only way through was through. And it was going to take community. I couldn't do it by myself. I had learned enough working with the community I was a part of. That community was important, that there is healing power in creating and encountering beauty through the works of our hands or through other people. And so I just gained some things while I was directing this project, thinking I was imparting things upon people. I gained some knowledge that helped me get through the grief. And I told Cleve, I was like, you know what? If I'm going to live this life, I want to continue being this mom for her, and I want to get a studio downtown, and I want to make art, and I want to sell art, and I'm not afraid anymore. You know, I had lost the thing that I was the most afraid of losing, and for some reason, I was still here, and I knew I just wasn't afraid anymore. I was afraid of not doing it. Does that make sense to anybody? Have you ever had that? Or just more afraid of not doing it than you were doing it, and I knew it was time for me to leap. And yeah, and I did it.
Yes, you did. I did it. Yeah. There's like a weird swimmy feeling to that kind of, I don't know. So in my mind, what I always remember in the first trying to see what could come out of the garbage pile of terror. And then, I was trying to see if I could, like, it was just storytelling, and I wasn't sure what memoir was, and this is my laptop hands. But I like signed up to go to one of those like retreats for writers, even though we just like put it all in quotation marks. And it was in Collegeville in like an old monastery in Minnesota, and I'm partial to the prairies. But what was so funny was it's such a beautiful program, and they sort of just house you and feed you and then let you write all afternoon. But there was like a junior high band camp that was a xylophone. I think it was like a xylophone orchestra that they could only practice outside. So I'm like crying my face off, and I'm trying to find that like glittering hard truth in the middle of what feels impossible to articulate. And then all I can hear is like dunga 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 dung from like a million 13-year-old boys.
But
it's like there was a weird feeling in there of like fear and then the joy, like when you almost like your heart can land. Like I would like creep my way up to the hardest, truest thought, and then I could see it there, and it was almost like just a relief to have it said, because I didn't realize how like scripted I had felt into, I mean, more convenient, more palatable lies.
Yeah, yeah.
Everything
resonates.
Works out for those who blah blah and don't worry is the most something something in the Bible, and
all of there's so many, the list goes on and on. And afterwards I started I did keep in my journal for a while, and then I turned it into art that doesn't need to be seen by anybody. and I realized, okay, I can let that go. But yeah, no, there's a list of things,
yeah.
And yeah,
yeah,
of the people we say to cope.
Yes.
There's a list of things I received, and you know, I had been doing a lot of work. The nature of my life, I feel like my dad's ministry and then my ministry ended up being so close to pain and hurt.
You're a pastor's kid.
I'm a pastor's kid.
You're like,
yeah, I got
bread.
Some friends out there who know how deep I'm a
really?
Pastor's kid.
I'd like to hear more.
And I've known me since yeah. little. but we'd been so close. So there are things that I saw, like, yeah. that spoke more complicated truths to those lies. And so I knew, like, okay, that may work for you, but that really doesn't work for me, you know? And I knew, too, that some of the things that were said to me was said because they loved me and they wanted me to be okay, you know, and wanted to ease the pain, and we just don't do the best job in our church communities or just equipping people with the language and the skills to cope with pain and suffering and to really just sit with people in the midst of that and know that we won't crumble, you know? Especially if we're together in it, we won't crumble.
Especially
and that's okay.
That. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I will absolutely lie most to the people I love.
Yeah.
Oh, it's gonna be okay.
Mm-hmm.
I can handle this.
Mm-hmm.
They're probably gonna find something, mm-hmm. you know? It is, there's so many beautiful things that become accidentally corrupted in love. And I wondered, and this is my, I took one art class. It was 8:30 in the morning at McAllister College, so I did not see much of that slideshow presentation. I did have a question about like the nature of abstraction. Like you're so comfortable in the abstract medium. And I was recently at the Whitney, that lovely art museum in New York, and I was at an exhibit by Jasper Johns, mm-hmm. who's that abstract impressionist? Are those the words?
It came a little bit after expressionist is probably, yeah, a little
you
bit after
things.
That movement.
Just insert nouns. I was wandering through and I saw this enormous piece that looked at first just like brown blobs, and then you see little handprints and little feet imprints, and it's named The Diver. And you realize in that moment, like, that man is drowning. And the, like, I've never felt quite so, like, claustrophobic in the most, like, it felt like the MRI when I was looking at it, like that feeling where you can't quite catch your breath. And and then, you know, and in the description you see that, like, but the suicide of a friend, and there's just something about mystery that you get to play with that I just wondered if you could reflect on.
Oh my gosh, you hit it on the head.
Yeah, great.
No, that's it. I mean, when I was exploring, like leaping into this as profession, but mostly during my grieving period, I was drawn to abstraction.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure if it was because a lot of abstraction is kind of dwindling the things down to like the most important thing, right? Like you're just like the elements are stripped and there's not, there's a lot of space for like mystery and questions and wonder and curiosity, you know? Some of the abstract expressionist pieces that particularly spoke to me during my period of grief, initial grief, were abstract expressionist paintings, and they were full of like this emotion and this feeling that connected to my rumblings better than anything that I was really reading. I turned a lot to poetry, which a lot of us during the pandemic turned to, because I do think there's something about people who can find the concise in the words, you know, to say the thing without a lot of things. And that's how abstraction kind of worked for me, how I encountered it or was encountered by it. And then it became this medium that I wanted to express through the works of my hands and just make visible what was within me. And it felt really natural, and I just wanted to learn as much as I possibly could about it.
Yeah.
And so that's where I began to lean, yeah. But I'm comfortable with the abstract. I'm very comfortable with it. So
I'm comfortable if I lay out like a spreadsheet and a chronology and then I explain it to you in about 300 heavily footnoted pages. I do think of you as someone I really trust to like kind of pluck things from the void. It is a magic that some people have more than others, and it really is why I thought of you when I. So as you know, I was having this like very. I prefer checklists. I prefer things I can plan. I prefer plans, especially when I'm scared. Mm. And the void and the mystery is not interesting to me anymore, thank you. I have like a low tolerance. And so I was in this very intense bucket list phase where I was really just imagining that what felt like the rest of a now limited life with a cancer diagnosis would mean that I wanted less mystery and more, I'm doing checklist hand, but like I wanted to know I had like gotten somewhere, accomplished it, figured it out, and then done it. And it seemed to me that like bucket list would not be the worst way to go. Here I am organizing incredible trips for my family. Behold, you know, I did a lot because I'm ridiculous. I did a lot of like enormous statues. So I said like the world's largest outdoor frying pan, which is not far away from here. Congratulations,
really?
North Carolina.
There's a thing.
Yeah, and they cook on it every year. It's really amazing.
That's
yeah.
Amazing.
There's also the world's largest pipe, which they smoke every year in Manitoba. But that's for lesser people, obviously. But I was forcing everyone to go to the Grand Canyon because I'd never seen it, and I thought that would surely sum up our lives. And I was driving by and I saw this little chapel, and like, owing to my love of very large but also very small things, like I've seen the world's largest Paul Bunyan, but also the world's smallest Paul Bunyan. I saw it and I like immediately pulled over, and it wasn't just like a little church. It was tiny. And when I went in, I initially thought that it had been vandalized because it looked like it was covered in graffiti. And then I realized when I looked at the walls, like rafters, walls, a stone altar in the front that people had written on, that it was completely covered, sometimes in paper, but sometimes carved into the wood, like prayers. Prayers that said, like nothing polite, you know? Like, please help my daughter be the way she was before.
Oh, yeah.
Or like, was the one that was just kind of like, Helen, can you hear me? And it was just, you know, the feeling of screaming into the void that everybody finally, it was like a place of raw, unfettered honesty.
Mm-hmm.
And there's something about the void, right? That like upward draft of grief, but also the possibility that something might answer back in the middle of that. So that experience made me want to reach for conversation and friends to help like render concrete something which feels like inexpressible but needs to be said.
Yeah.
So anyway, so when you know, we get a lot of really beautiful honesty that comes toward the Everything Happens project. And so when we thought about trying to make something out of it, I immediately thought of you because of your unbearably high tolerance for mystery and void making. I wondered if maybe we could talk about that for a minute, like
sure.
What the process was like. It was kind of a lot. I was like, hey, I have like
great.
A lot of really sad stuff to share with you. Would you like to make something with me?
No, it was so, like when I got the invitation, I was one, excited because your work has definitely spoken to me the deepest parts of myself as I've journeyed with making a life these days. So thank you for your work. And then the invitation came, and I don't do a lot of collaboration in my like work.
Sure.
I collaborate with people all the time, but as far as making the work. And so I was a little nervous. I was like, I'm not sure is this gonna work.
Well, I didn't know what I was doing. I was just hoping you would have great ideas, but then you immediately had great ideas.
Because like we had the conversation and I think I was throwing out things that y'all were so polite. And I was just like, yeah, okay, let's keep talking about these. And then someone sent me your words about the chapel. And that's when it clicked, like, oh, the visual. They were, you wrote about it so beautifully, and it took me there. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, I see the possibilities of this piece. And literally, you guys, it was 9 months. I did the math from when you asked me to us bringing it to this space to be seen. Yeah. 9 months of working together and dreaming and conceptualizing this piece and then creating the work that then we could offer and share. And so the work is made from an old pallet, wood pallet, that was from a construction site, building a residence. And it's made of paper. I just really love the imagery of the paper walls and paper.
Yeah, it was that line, like, something like, I realize that my life is made of paper walls, and so is everyone else's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, yes.
And then you were like, I make things with paper. All the time.
Right. It just made sense. That's where I was like landing in my own work.
Yeah.
And paper is fragile, you know, but there are mediums you can use to make it strong. I mean, there were just so many metaphors. In abstraction too, I lean heavily on metaphors and textures and layers. And so the work just, it made sense, and it came to be in a way that was really me, but then also was everybody else who was a part of the conversation.
We asked people that were at Duke Divinity School, so lots of like lovely students handwrote things, and then we asked the community online if they would send in or put on our website a response to like a finishing of the sentence, in my life there is no cure for.
Yeah.
And we got hundreds and hundreds of responses, and there really is, there's something about the sound of honesty that, like, you know, I have this beautiful team, and they did such a great job bringing everything together, and then as my Harriet and my Jess and my Gwen and my Jesse, and they, we hear these stories all the time, and we pray about them and think about them, but one of the ways that we always think about it is almost like it flicks a chord and like rings transcendent. Mm-hmm. And you say that so beautifully about like the particularities. Like once you, the more specific.
Oh yeah, my sister is a poet, and she says that they talk a lot about like in poetry, the more personal you are, the more universal. And sometimes in art, making visual arts, you're kind of encouraged not to be so, think outward. But I'm very inward anyway, so that's the nature of my work, inward, outward. But I found that as I was reading, because part of the practice was sitting with the website and reading before I would begin the work, what people had shared their truths, and just holding that space with them. And I found as I was reading, and some of the truths, you know, are not my story, and none of them were my story. Some of them were close, I could empathize more quickly because I know what it's like to lose a child. I know what it's like to experience death, you know, of a loved one. But there were some that were shared that I didn't. But as I sat with them in that honesty, it kind of opened me up to realize the connections too, of just like, oh, but I have experienced someone I love being absent, you know, and it may not be my mom, but I know what it's like, you know, and I found these common threads that encouraged some empathy and belonging and connection in ways that made me feel less alone. And I imagine, like in your work, right? Like, tell me about it. What is that like?
Because I guess one of the first. One of the first lies we believe. I mean, it kind of does feel like deeply satanic in that way, like the little perversion of the voice that says, like, you are alone in this. You know, and we feel trapped in our own bodies and in our own lives, and then we start to believe, like, we are alone, no one would love you in this. Like, mm-hmm. And you see everyone else carry it too, that their pain will always be too much. That if it happens, even, you know, whether they're the, you know, whether it's cancer or addiction or a failure of a relationship or just like exhaustion in caregiving for someone who no longer feels delightful, you know, that there is the feeling that we are too much and then we become the bad thing. And I found it very hard to not feel like I was the bomb that was gonna blow up the lives of everyone who loves me. You know, congratulations, thanks for loving me. I'm about to make things really awful for you. So there is something, I mean, I brought some of them. They're like, you know, a child's death. Like in my life, there is no cure for divorce. In my life, there is no cure for chronic illness, addiction. A reason to wear his ring, you know, like in the details of other people's love, there's something so like exquisite about that love. Cause like in the grief, in the it was and can't be again, it just, it feels like people aren't just screaming pain into the void, they're screaming love into the void.
Oh yeah. And I felt that.
Yeah.
You know, I felt that. And I think that's probably one of the ways that I was able to really continue carrying that, because it was, I was composing the really heart of the piece during a real deep grief cycle part in my life.
Yeah.
But there was that reminder of the love, right? And there's the poem, On Joy and Sorrow, that talks about how joy makes room, like sorrow is because of the joy that we experience and the love that we have, you know, and the two are like one and the same. And, you know, I've complicated that a little bit because I can feel both simultaneously at the same time, and that's very real for me. But there is that's also a truth, right? And I felt that love, I felt of so many people as they were sharing so bravely on your site publicly. The things that there's just no cure for, and very poetically, like as you were reading, it was like, and it was really powerful.
Can you tell me about some of the, because I'd love for y'all to, on your way out, especially at the end, if you just would, there's some lovely features that are, poetic.
Yes, so on the piece, some of the layers are actually words from the website, and so some are more prominent than others, and that's just by the nature of how my hands flowed and the paper layered. But like, there's no cure for past regrets. Uncertainty came up a lot, and that was something I could resonate with as one who's very anxious all the time, the uncertainty of life. And so I worked words as well as a couple of images in there to symbolize things that were shared. I spent some time in some books and finding lines. I just really wanted to be as intentional and honor what was shared as much as possible in the way in which I received time with people's stories. And so loss, COVID, a lot of COVID grief, a lot of divorce and suicide. Like there were just a lot of things that a lot of people who had experienced discrimination because of who they are, you know? It's not even so much who they love, just who they are, you know? And those things too, all of it just kind of opened up space. The reliquary, the Catholics believe that it's a healing, like there's a healing aspect to placing these relics in the reliquary. And so I found that as I was doing it and having to confront my own life story and, that it was also some healing power in that for me and grace.
You picked the name, and you couldn't have picked a better. I mean, I loved when, if you wouldn't mind saying the name, why you chose it, you beautiful creature.
Reliquary of Complicated Truths. And part of it flowed from a conversation I had with my studio mate about the work. And Theaster Gates is an artist that we love, and he has done some reliquary work, and she had mentioned that. And then that led to your book at the end of it. Like I sat and I just read it through. It was like 2 days. I wasn't going to studio. I just couldn't put it down kind of thing. And then at the end, there's like this nice little cherry on top where you had this list of more complicated, like truths.
Oh, yeah, things people say.
And then the more complicated truths.
That's true. I was really grouchy when I wrote that. Oh my. I was like, I get these really ragey appendices.
It was great.
Yeah, it was like something like carpe diem.
Yeah, right.
And then I was like, yeah, unless you need a nap.
Unless you need a nap.
That's right.
Right? That one just like.
There was one that's like, let go and let God. And I was like, you can trust God, but he's not going to do your taxes.
Right.
Like I don't know.
Yeah, no. And I love the one about how we always talk about like being present. And I know there's something in about the contemplative practice, spiritual practice of presence is one that is important. There's things there. However, you said a more complicated truth is that we toggle between past, present, and future.
Yeah.
All the time.
And
it's so real for me. That just was like, yes.
Thank you
That's
for
real.
Saying that, because I felt very oppressed by the be present paradigm.
Mm.
You know, like there's just some mindfulness gurus out there who are really, like, really disappointed in me.
I'm sure. And even when I was in some conversation, people were like, but being present, I was like, but no, if we're honest, right?
Yeah.
Like, I do flow. Like, in the same moments, it's just like the past is always with me, and I'm thinking about the future, and I'm very present to, like, now. It's all there. And it resonated with just the work that I do because of the nature of the images and things that I do in my work. It was like, yeah.
Because you
take
other material and then you like make it into
archival material I'm drawn to, and I'm always imagining future possibilities.
Yeah.
But sitting with like the truth of our lives here. So like in the piece, there's newspapers of current events that were happening. There's some tissue paper from like gifts that we have, so real fragile, thin, rice paper, book pages, all of them just kind of like holding these stories. And and the whole process was one of uncertainty and a play and of letting go. Like I just had to let go a lot in the piece.
I didn't think about the fact that the past, present, future is such a, you're right. Because the past is so full of pain and beauty and things that were, and you know, bodies that worked and youth, whatever that was fun. Some of it wasn't. But I mean, sometimes like when I want to treasure the past, you know, and not just mourn it, I think, I think of the first time I saw Zach, my kid's enormous froggy eyes, you know, and then they were just like giant flashlight tractor beams.
Yes.
And then when I think about that, I'm able to at any moment, like no matter how scary my life is, the moment, you know, right before being pushed into surgery, I can think like, thank God I have that. That is already mine. You know, that feels like breadcrumbs,
mm-hmm.
you know, scattered all over.
Oh yeah. You know, and just my community, ancestors, our story is just so important. And I love to talk about Dr. Willie Jennings every chance I get.
Yeah.
But he, when I was at Duke, he was one of the professors that just has remained with me, even in this work that I do now as an artist. And one of his courses, he started off by talking about the power of story. And that we're born into stories not of our own choosing, and just we're stories all the way to the bone, and we choose stories, and they choose us, and all of these things. And I bring that to the heart of my work, is this kind of storytelling and understanding the layers of it and how it shapes us, the stories that we choose and that we live into and that choose us as well.
Yeah, that choose us, exactly.
Yeah, and that piece is just full of these stories. And yeah, and there's strength in that, in remembering sometimes, too.
Yeah.
That helps me get through, like you said, like these moments of just, I think part of my resilience building is just the ability to remember, as well as to reimagine and imagine future possibilities right now, you know? And that's important to me. So,
because American culture has one for you, just one story, which is that you are a chooser.
Right.
You are the invincible chooser who stands on the precipice of every day with infinite possibilities.
It's a lie.
Yeah.
You know, in a sense, it is. And so I'm leaning into liberation in all things and trying to understand it all. And invite other people. And that's what I love with the work that you're doing. And it's inviting people into a new way of seeing that feels liberating, There's something cool about saying, like, I'm human. And then there's no cue for it, and it's good.
Yeah.
And it's full of all kinds of messy things, and it's complex. And,
yeah,
I'm not alone in that.
I guess I wondered, maybe as our last thing before we ask Taylor to come back up, is then if we're not people of exhausting futurism, you know, or and we still want to carry the past forward in longing and love, how do we describe being hopeful? What does hope mean to you?
Yeah, you know, I'd love to know what it means to you. For me, it's just showing up to life every day. Like, just kind of waking up and believing that there's something that I can contribute to this day, and this day has something for me. You know, in art making, we've talked about this before, has helped me be a more hopeful person, I would say. Because there's times when life hits you so hard that it's hard to kind of hold on to, you know, and the practice of making, of showing up to my canvas. And I think artists have something to teach us about this, you know. Taylor goes to her guitar and she's hopeful and she's somewhat faithful that, like, when she starts playing, that something will come, you know. And on the canvas, I approach it and I begin to move because I have hope that it will not always be blank, you know, that something will come. And so I've learned to apply that to my life as well, and I know that it takes action. You know, it takes me not only saying, like, oh, a painting, I see a painting possibility on that blank canvas. It actually takes me doing some work, right, and living into and accepting limitations and then being wowed by things that I wasn't expecting, or just, like, saying, whoa, I did that. I knew how to, you know. It's like all of these things. That also apply to, and I try to apply it to my living as well.
Yeah.
But I just believe what is, I deep down in my heart, there's a lot of things in my faith formation that I have had needed to let go of in order to keep moving forward with God, with people. But one thing I do believe is, like, what is doesn't have to be.
Yes,
and that
great.
It's something is possible.
Yeah.
Better things are possible. And so I just keep leaning into that and know when the bad things come, I truly hope and believe that the people and the love will be around me to carry me through.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And just when you said that about the, I remember a conversation, it was like one of my first podcast guests, it was an author named Jason Green,
okay.
And he had just lost his daughter in a really tragic, random accident, and he is not a person of faith, and he was trying to describe what hope felt like, and he said, like, that even, like, in the dark expanse of the night sky, that there will be stars. And I think that there is, you know, for us, a story that God, you know, that God is in the future drawing us toward, that there will be, you know, that there is magic there for us, there is love there for us. And every time you say, like, you know, that this blank canvas won't be blank forever, it fills me with incredible joy to know you and to see new magic be made. So I thank you for being with me in culturally unacceptable, not nice for polite company truths, complicated truths.
Yeah.
And I wondered if, so Taylor, beautiful, sweet, gorgeous Taylor is going to come up and play another song for us. And I'm going to say two things, and then I'm going to say something after Taylor plays. But I'm going to remind you that Vespers is at 7, and it is a beautiful time if you feel like joining. And I'm just going to say that because it's lovely. And if you heard people singing, I think that that's, I think they're coming. And that I would love it if you wanted to pass by Lanecia's gorgeous reliquary, and that is, like, stuffed with people's beautiful, complicated truths. So let's listen to a little bit more magic before we go.
Lord, I've prayed your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Today it's hard to believe in. When hell has never come quite so close, I see the whites of his eyes, and oh, I feel the breaking of every bone. What do I do now that all the light's gone out? How many times have I promised to walk through the smoke and the fire with you? That was long before I ever knew the flame. Not them, not this, not the thing that I cannot fix. The house is burning and I'm helpless, I'm helpless. What do I do now that all the light's gone out? What do find at the bottom of this bitter drink, this awful cup, when all the pain's been swallowed up? Will it make us different? Will we say with confidence that the love was worth the risk, that the end is joy? Blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Thank you, Taylor, and just thank you so much, Lanecia.
Thank you.
Your tenderness and your the porous way that you love and bless us has been a real gift to me, and I know to others. Thank you so much, my dear. Thank you. All right, my darlings. Well, before we close, I just want to bless the crap out of you. Does that feel? Dean Edgardo Colon and Barico, am I allowed to say crap in this chapel? Here we go. All right, so here's a blessing for when there's no cure. for being human. God, I feel it again, the burden of being human and the fact that nothing will exempt us from the pain of it. Blessed are we, your human creatures, with mind and soul and spirit bounded in flesh and bone, struggling in the seeming conspiracy against progress amidst the perfection that our minds can grasp and our hearts long for. God, how we yearn for the completion of all things. And oh, how we try to hurry it along with our self-help elixirs, slurries with a touch of truth and a handful of goodness, enough to be effective for a while. The gospel of hustle or of positivity or Peloton. But then life happens and we realize all over again that we are human, frail and finite, and that there's no cure for that, despite illusory promises that say otherwise. This is where we live. In this reality, come help us in our humanity. Help us enjoy all the beauty that is here, the sweetness that comes to us unbidden, the light that gives eyes to see. It's not all up to us. Thank heaven. Amen. All right, my loves, goodbye, and thank you for coming. Much appreciated.
Thank you.
Thank you, loves. You got stuff.